stories from the dancing and the music. It's very energizing for me to see that. My little piece is called Storytelling for Cultural Survival and Continuity. We found that more specific peoples see sustainable development or define it as cultural survival and continuity, which is slightly different from the way UNESCO sees ESD. I talk about telling stories because that's what I'm going to be doing now, is to share with you some of my stories. Artists love to tell stories. That is what propels them to produce and create. Storytelling predates both art and education as we know them today. In our work, whether it is painting, music, sculpture, or writing, we interpret and tell stories. Even in our silences, we wait to hear a story. Our ancestors told many stories, which we continue to hear if we listen carefully. Their stories were passed on by word of mouth, often sung and performed, and fashioned valuable objects out of the materials that were available to them at the time, whether these were dwelling or meeting places, canoes or ornaments. Their stories were always passionate because they were about relationships between them and nature and among themselves. Today, their voices are often drowned in loud, new, artificial, and now virtual sounds, but they are still there, living within us where the spirit lives. For me, writing is my way of passing on my stories mingled with theirs. You come clad in your fine mats and tupper cloth, your brown skin bursting with fresh perfumed oil, your eyes shining like stars in a clear night, you, the choice of my parents. You will give them wealth and fame with your Western type education and second-hand car. But you do not know me, my prince, save that I am firstborn and have known no other man. In these days, especially in education, in formal education, there are very few spaces for us, the people of Oceania, to share our stories. Even in higher education and in university in particular, we have assumptions that are based on secularism, universalism, objectivity, equality, criticism, and passionlessness. The antidote of the assumptions of our cultures, which includes spirituality, specific context, subjectivity, restraint, and passion. Here at USB, for example, we expect everyone to be treated equally according to certain specified rules said to be based on merit, and we pretend to treat individuals according to objective criteria of individual achievement. Yet we know that students who go to university do not start their journeys from the same place or use similar travel guides. And we continue to believe that formal education provides the means whereby our culturally diverse peoples could aspire to and achieve common prizes offered in society by creating a single measure of personal success, the attainment of wealth and status, by promotion to professional and senior management positions within corporate and public bureaucracies. In such a context, the arts and the cultures of the peoples of Oceania have been and continue to be marginalized because they were and still are seen as primitive or barriers to the agenda of higher education and modern development. The story of oceanic cultures and their arts is a story of struggle, a story that has continued to go unheard, not for lack of tellers, but a lack of listeners. Perhaps it is time for us, the people of Oceania, to start listening more closely to one another's stories, even if others are not willing to listen. When I was an undergraduate at the Auckland University in the 1960s, I was exposed exclusively to the stories, the cultures that produced the stories and the knowledge that were considered worthwhile and the values that underpinned them. Art was European art, and literature was English and American literature. Higher education for those of us from Oceania meant hanging our cultural orientations and identifications on the strong branches of the magnolia trees at Albert Park and forgetting about who we were for a while. The only art I learned at university was the art of forgetting. A weekend in Auckland is good for discovering again old meeting places in the park, hoping they have stories to tell about the adventures of a once youthful time. Down under the magnolia trees, the bench which took the weight of our first kiss is still there. The fountain continues to beat like an artificial heart, and the flowers continue to die with each passing day. And there, hovering high above, in the tower clock, now dwarfed by the reality of its own time. A striking shadow, a reminder that the heart's best defense at this time is forgetting. More recently, however, people seem to have changed their minds. They say there's no real justification for claiming that a specific perspective or view of knowledge is a better representation of reality compared to another. People in universities now say that this is part of cultural politics, and those who subscribe to such a view are called postmodernist. Postmodernism is an ideology that emphasizes the importance of images, signs, and language in the constitution of the self and society. Postmodernists are critical of grand theories and images of the social and economic world, which they say are predominantly white, male, and metropolitan, and place people like women and people of color in positions of oppression. Postmodernists reject many things, including age-old scientific claims to objective truth, the so-called canons of Western art and literature, as well as the grand narratives the Enlightenment. I was attracted to postmodernism because it seemed to counter the totalizing perspective that has been held up by many so-called liberal people and societies who see disadvantaged people like ourselves as a problem to be solved and as victims of our own incompetence. But I later came to see postmodernism as a perspective that is ahistorical, because linking truth and power and saying that social life is a continuing conflict between the dominated and the dominating seemed to me to conflict with the fact that our oceanic cultures have a past, a very long past, in fact, that is authentic and material to the well-being of all of us in Oceania. When we consider the history of formal education in Oceania, we find that it is relatively recent. Its introduction was part of a grand European design to discover, civilize, and Christianize our world, and the rest you know. The impetus for higher education development in Oceania ostensibly arose from the need for Pacific colonial powers to hand over the administration of Pacific Island countries to Pacific peoples themselves, as long as the wise counsel of ex-masters went heeded. Some colonial leaders, as well as a few Pacific Islanders, realizing this and experiencing the high failure rate of students sent to metropolitan countries for further studies, came to adopt a theory that links the security of oceanic cultural identity and self-esteem to educational performance. The establishment of the University of Papua New Guinea and our university was based on that assumption. that students learning in their own cultural context and where possible in their own languages were more likely to be successful than if they were educated in a monolingual, monocultural educational environment. The growth and expansion of Pacific writing in English in the South Pacific was closely associated with Pacific higher education institutions such as UPNG and USP. Involving what we now call the first wave in the 1960s and 70s, and later a new wave in the 80s and 90s. But like all our other arts, it has not been easy for writers to continue to write or publish their works. While the Pacific Festival of Arts is helping keep our traditional art forms such as dance, poetry, and music alive, it has been a struggle to keep the literary arts alive. And apart from a few people such as Albert Wentz, Satendra Nandan, Subramanian, perhaps myself, many writers from the first wave have stopped writing in order to become politicians, businessmen, or bureaucrats. Later, here in 1999, we hosted the South Pacific Association of Commonwealth Literature and Language Conference, and that was good for many of us to continue to share our stories. But sadly, since then at USP, we haven't had too many such events. Sorry. In the Oceania, I want to look at the Oceania Center now. It took USP almost 30 years to establish and approve a center for arts and culture. And despite its popularity and attractiveness to both students and members of the wider community, it has continued to be seen by many as a place for music and dance and entertainment and not serious study that goes on in faculties, in schools, and institutes. In the Oceania Center, we wanted a center that would represent the cultural and artistic diversity of Oceania and not just another university art school. For a long time, we wondered whether it was possible to believe in aesthetic values that were different from that which most of us who received our higher education in the West had been conditioned to believe in. I am glad that the stage is now set for us to begin the rethinking and the conversation that the new director of the Oceania Center spoke to us about. I want to focus on the literature, on the literary arts of the Pacific, to share with you some of my experiences. Bennett's rather cynical definition of literature is interesting to me. He says that literature is an institutional arrangement for the processing of text and is what institutions of higher learning and the book trade have chosen to define as such. Unlike the literatures of the West, Pacific vernacular literature, especially poetry, are usually meant to be performed and consist of particular text or compositions with particular textual properties, much of which, unfortunately, are yet to be seriously analyzed. Until now, the opportunities for such studies have been very limited, as what has been seen to be more important subjects, both for students and those that send them to university, continue to be accounting, economics, management, and more recently, computing and information technologies. This is probably because they are seen as a clear path towards securing well-paid jobs. Furthermore, some of our students simply do not want to continue the often boring and painful study of English literature that they were subjected to at school, where their own arts and literatures were considered primitive and did not count for much. But just as Westerners value and persist with studying their own valued text, so there are some people in Oceania who value and study theirs, both ancient and contemporary. In my view, At USB, we need to work out what is worth studying and get on with the business of creating and studying both our oral and written text and contribute our particular insights to the history of Pacific social consciousness. In relation to oceanic arts in general, my uncle Futa suggests that also that although universities cannot devise tests for truth, value and validity in these art forms, particular periods stand out in quality because of their universal appeal. In this sense, the arts of indigenous peoples are worthy, certainly worthy of study. But the reluctance of many institutions of higher learning, and sadly, I have to admit, including USP, to value Pacific arts and oral literatures is, of course, a legacy of our colonial education. Pacific educators must persist with examining oral text. After all, it is what we do when we discuss a film, a book, or a video we've just seen. Let me now say a few words about dance to illustrate the complexities of that particular art form and why it is imperative for higher education, including USP, to include this and other oceanic arts in their formal curriculum. Dance, according to experts, is poetry in motion. The visual accompaniment of poetry is a visual extension of literature. Dance is a feature of Pacific cultures that separates them from cultures in which dance does not interpret literature. The literature interpreting dance tradition of most oceanic cultures continues elements of literature, music, and dance in a very unique artistic form. In Oceania, a dancer is a storyteller who does not dramatize in the visual sense of the word, but interests the audience because of the closeness of the observer's understanding of sophisticated figurative poetry and the subtleties of movement. The lack of dramatization makes it difficult and even impossible to follow a story or even know that one exists. The movement themselves, although certainly graceful and perhaps even erotic sometimes, can become eventually boring to those who are not able to follow the story. Like the dance literary traditions of Polynesia, Tongan dance illustrates the use of sophisticated poetic devices and levels of interpretation. And while movements may refer to selected words of poetry, the words themselves may refer to quite hidden meanings. Poets compose poetry, add music and movement, and rehearse the performances before a public ceremony. A poet through dance usually pays allegiance to rank-based social-political systems, reflecting and validating the system of social distinction and interpersonal relationships. The natural environment, and here is the link to sustainable development, the natural environment and other earthly features, such as the sea, the sky, the moon, the stars, and the sun, are important symbols Tongan and oceanic poetry, as well as in the visual arts such as taba motifs and the incising of war clubs. Such celestial bodies symbolize the highest chiefs, the sun being in Tonga the symbol of the king or queen. For example, when Queen Salote passed away in Auckland, I was a student there, and the manager announced the sun is fallen. In the poetry of the dance Laka Laka, a relatively modern Tongan dance, a series of concepts and references are composed to commemorate a particular event and to tell a story. Specific words are used to, and hand movements and allusions are often used to refer to mythology and genealogies, illustrating the Tongan poetic ideal of heliaki, or not going straight. Some allusions are understood by everyone, but most are understood only by a few people, especially other poets. In order to understand a poetic transformation, one must work from her knowledge gained through the study of genealogy, mythology, and history. Don't have those studies at USB. The use of symbolism or heliaki are employed in this little poem called Woven Worlds. Yesterday I watched your hands weave a dream across my memory, bringing order and texture to the pile of voivoi still there, filling the valley that once was home. Today I watch your hands move across the page, across the canvas, across the room, releasing energy, arranging tapestries, symphonies of touch and color. Each day we come together to weave feelings, experiences, images, to sing the songs our mothers and grandmothers, long continuous lines connecting east and west, north and south, and recreate the world. Lakalaka poetry also has form and characteristically contains different parts. In Lakalaka, the four dimensions of Tongan aesthetics are clearly illuminated. They are craftsmanship, appropriateness, the skill and feeling of the performers, and the inner state of knowledge of the spectators. Dance, then, for Tongans is a physical, mental, and aesthetic activity to be enjoyed at one or more levels simultaneously. Some dance genres are primarily at one or another, aim at one or another of these possible levels. Dance in Oceania demonstrates that non-Western cultures do have a verbalized aesthetic which applies not only to structure and performance but to emotional states as well. In order for non-Oceanic people, especially Westerners, to understand these different ways of thinking about the arts, they must be prepared to accept other ways of seeing and other aesthetics that are different from their own. Only in this way would they move from a mere appreciation of Oceanic arts to understanding them. I have been using the term culture to refer to a way of life of a people that includes their knowledge and value systems expressed in their language. In Oceania, just as it is in the West, our arts, like philosophy, literature, and religion, are important vehicles of our cultural expression. It follows, therefore, that the ways we talk, think about, and judge the arts are influenced by our cultures and their standards of production and performance. These standards, of course, constitute the aesthetics of a culture. However, in order for a person of one culture to understand the aesthetic principles of another, she needs to understand the cultural values and principles of the other culture, as well as the criteria for making aesthetic judgments. I'm getting to the end. Our expressive products, then, be they a performance, a picture, or a poem, is created by an artist who has a special place in our society. What is created symbolizes our beliefs and emotions that are meant to inspire, thus connecting aesthetics and culture. The artist specializes in creating symbolic representations that convey the spirit of a culture or an age, though she may not be aware of that she's doing that. I consider myself as both a student of culture and an expressive artist. During my 44 years at USP, I have experienced different cultures and witnessed many art forms, and I'm thankful to all those who shared with me in this way. However, if I say that I saw and felt the same things about other people's art as they do, I am deluding myself, just as I do not expect you to see and feel the same when watching a Tongan Lakalaka or reading one of my poems. Unlike dance poetry, my writing started as an attempt to make basic elements of English poetry understandable to my English Form 5 class. Although my artistic roots lie in an oral tradition, where the storyteller creates an audience In a way, a writer can only imagine. My Western education taught me that a poem was a thing that is seen as separate from its creator. In my writing, therefore, I try to create a synthesis between Tongan and English, producing perhaps what some people call a third space. A consequence is that in my belief, it is my belief that my poem has to sound good, because in reading it, I join together the silences of words and making them come alive. Here's a poem about foreign aid dependence, which in my mind is the biggest challenge to sustainable development in Oceania. It's called Words. Today your words are empty, sucking dry the brown dust left by earth and sky, patches politely parched with no water flowing from the mountain top, scars burn on my soft skin. You've cut a piece of me away, leaving my bandaged heart to endure the pain of your tying me to yourself. I continue to write, and I continue to believe in education, despite the hurdles and the barriers I have faced in terms of promoting the importance of culture and the arts. It is a value that drives much of our work as educators here at USB and elsewhere. And it is the value that also drives the international campaign for education for all and education for sustainable development. It is through education that most of us can learn to share our stories with one another. But it is poetry that gives the body soul. Whether the words are woven, painted, performed, sculptured, sung, spoken, written, or recorded. Some words need a brush, others need a pen, and still others, movement, gesture, and intonation. Poetry connects us to the vast ocean and to one another. As this little poem suggests, you need not fear poetry, its mystery and secret ways. Rather, you should love, and only then will you know her name. Her voluptuous voice will wake your blood, her touch will warm the air around you, and in your extended heartbeat will be the living proof that my invitation is real.